you know, the thing about the United States is, of course, we all love the idea of freedom and individuality, but I, when I'm being honest with myself, the way I manifest my image of freedom and individuality for myself is to say, please love me, everyone. Isn't it so cool how I'm doing it? Because I genuinely care about other people and how I interact with them. The social fabric really matters to me. And it took me a little while to mature and understand that, you know, I felt like, okay, there's the social fabric has a lot of mindless conformity and I'm against that, but I wasn't against people. I deeply care about people. And so reminding people that how we have the freedom to be who we want to be is actually almost always intertwined with how that freedom then allows us to present ourselves to other people and, yes, and to interact with other people and to say, I want this freedom, but I will oppress someone else's freedom because I think it gets in the way of mine is just inherently hypocritical.
Yes, it is, isn't it? And like one way I feel like, I think in a way, we don't have the option of excluding spirituality from the manner in which we organize our systems, which is another way of saying politics, of course, because we're all like, it is already spiritual. It's just whether it's going to be clear, direct and bona fide spirituality or oxymoronic, hypocritical, some broken spirituality. Because like the idea that, you know, that freedom or must be afforded to all or it isn't freedom at all is a kind of, I've just made that up, I think. If that's not copyrighted, we should copyright it. You could stick it on a t-shirt for fuck's sake, because I just don't have the infrastructure. That, like, you know, for me, that's a very, you know, when I talk about like spirituality, I feel like we need new ways to vivify the political process. We need new ways to include people that are feeling maligned. I think we need new ways of getting past this impasse of polarization that I see in your country and in mine. And I feel that there's two things. I feel that the bridge may include the reincorporation of some spiritual ideals. The other thing I feel that decentralization on a massive scale and challenging what it means to be part of a nation, and if a nation can ever again benefit its inhabitants, or if it's so baked into the process now that its true beneficiaries are powerful transnational corporations, that it can never again be something that is democratically accessible to its population.
Well, the power loves to protect itself. I mean, it's hard to, when corporations accumulate so much power and that's that goes unchecked, and then people also become used to it. It's really hard to move back from that. But, you know, there were times in the early 20th century when corporations were broken up and there were efforts to reinvigorate competition. And I'm not at all a believer in the market solves all problems. I do understand the principle of competition and the idea that it drives people who make something to create the version with the most merit to persuade an audience to support them, and I think that that can have its benefits. But the consolidation of power is a really big problem, because that actually diminishes that desire to improve the product, and it just pushes people to use their leverage. Yes. You know, when it's all just about profit and not merit, and that's really, and I mean, there's so many problems I have with capitalism, especially when we're on a planet of a finite size with a growing population and diminishing resources. That is not sustainable. But the idea of getting back to a more know your neighbor, decentralized take on things, it is something that I believe in philosophically, because I think when people are accountable to their community, they behave very differently than when they think, oh, if I buy this or support that, it's sort of, the impact is nebulous. When they can see the impact in a meaningful way that actually tugs at their conscience, that really matters. And then if that can sort of be, telegraphed out into their practices, that even without being able to see directly the end result, but sort of being able to imagine it and then empathize, these are really important ideas. I don't think people have lost their capacity for empathy.
How can they have
done? I think they just compartmentalize things.
I think you're right. I think we are directed to. I think that when our biochemical drives are directed by cultural systems that continually bias us towards, prejudice us towards individualism, materialism, then what choice do we have? I was thinking how personal this is to me, that my own narrative has been like, growing up, feeling unappreciated and powerless, wanting to become famous and successful and have access to the glorious spoils of commerce and capitalism, to be attractive, to be wanted, to be powerful, to be glorious, experiencing, oh shit, it's meaningless, it doesn't work, it doesn't address the thing that I was trying to address in the first place, sense of worthlessness, alienation, loneliness, all of that those things have been untouched, and then being taught that the only way I'm ever going to address those things is by prioritizing it, first acknowledging it's a problem, then being willing to be eventually finding myself in a position where I'm willing to prioritize the service of others over my own material and emotional and spiritual needs. And that still, there's a tension in that for me. I still sometimes have to make myself go and like, right, oh God, I'm feeling unhappy. What's that thing I'm supposed to do? Oh yeah, be kind to other people and be of service to them. Still, like, it's still, while, and then I do it and it actually works. I go and do some, like, I know you do a lot of philanthropic work. Sometimes I find it more effective, actually, the less grandiose or visible it is. Sometimes when it is small, but oddly meaningful transactions, like small demonstrations of my acceptance that I'm just a small participant in this limitless game, like that, somehow it's so rewarding to me, so rewarding, because it enforces, I suppose, the idea that actually a human individual is more, it's a human being is an event rather than an object. Human being is, we have so many things in common with one another. We rise up out of the abyss, out of the nothingness. Temporarily, we seem to be an individual thing. Then we collapse back into the dust. But there are universal and eternal principles that somehow, when we, that chime with us, when we live in accordance with them, honor, integrity, kindness, authenticity, we know that when we hit that frequency, we resonate more strongly. I feel its power when I'm like willing to do something for someone else, even more so when I'm willing to do something for someone else and not get found out in having done it, and like, for me, that these ideas cannot be expressed safely in these systems. Like you said, power has to protect itself, and I feel that the power in the sort of great democracies that we've been discussing is so entrenched that it knows, firstly, to make itself invisible. It knows how to maintain the minor fluctuations that may be that viscerally impactful and real to people that are watching the spectacle from the outside. It knows how, like, who, have any powerful interests been meaningfully impacted by the transition of recent administrations? I would be very surprised if they had been. If any real global players are like, oh shit, well, that's messed with our business model. I don't know.
Thanks for watching this podcast and going all the way to the end of it. Would you be so kind as to click the bell? Might not be there, but over there. And subscribing so that we can infiltrate your serenity and peace of mind with jangling bells and buzzes. Thank you.